I like to call our financial empowerment workshop, right? Because the whole point, the whole intent of this is not just to throw financial information at you, it's not just to throw scriptures at you, it's really to help you merge those two worlds, right? To merge what you believe in your faith and what you know about your finances and make those two things one so that you become empowered. By empowered, I mean you make decisions that benefit your family, that benefit your community, benefit the church, benefit the kingdom. That's what this is all designed to do. Like, it's really designed to empower you and give you more power as you operate in your financial space every day. If you don't mind, quickly, you're just going to stand to our feet. If you don't mind, if you're able to, just going to stand for a word of prayer. Last week, I started with the affirmations. You know that I'm really, really big on preparing our mindset as we get to study finances today. I'm going to do something a little bit different, and I just want us to pray to God before we start to go into this information. So, if you wouldn't mind praying with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, this opportunity to come before you to not only study your word, but to also learn how we can make better financial decisions, how we can apply wisdom, how we can apply discipline, how we can apply stewardship and responsibility, so that ultimately we use the resources, the wealth that you've blessed us with, build up our families, build up our communities, build up our kingdom, build up your kingdom, rather, so that we can truly make a difference, we can truly add value. So pray that that you use me, Father, the things that I'll teach and reveal and educate on will bring you glory, and that they will truly transform lives at the conclusion of this, Father. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And appreciate you all. Appreciate you all. Again, Paul. Going to start, you know that I'm really, really interactive when I try to do these workshops and so forth. So I want to start just getting a little bit of an understanding from the, you know, I know we got a small audience here, but I'm curious to know, what exactly do you all want? What do you want to come as a result of learning about your finances, about showing up here? Why did you show up? What is it that you're hoping to receive? I see your hand about to go up, so we'll start with financial stability. Okay, we talked about that last time, right? What does that mean, that financial stability? Income coming in versus the expenses that are going out, right? That's financial stability. Okay, all right, that's something we can accomplish. Anybody else? What are we looking to, what are you hoping to accomplish? If you can't leave here without anything else, what's one thing that you want to just leave here today with in terms of information, motivation, inspiration, like anything? Anything. I'm sorry? Spiritual perspective, in addition to the financial information and how we relate to money, how we use money, coming from a spiritual perspective. We want to also make sure it's biblically based. We want to make sure the scriptures are there. We want to make sure we have financial stability when we leave here, or at least start taking steps. And I'm sorry, you had something as well.
What's a good investment to make?
What's a good investment to make? Okay, so we want to find out what are some good things for us to invest in. Okay, all right. So we want to find out anything.
I invested in properties, but then I had to let go because of my situation. I couldn't work and I lost the houses to the bank.
Okay, so your circumstances changed a little bit versus when you first started out investing in it. Okay, all right, that makes sense. So we want to make sure that we're understanding where we should be putting our money, where we're investing, financial stability, biblically based. We want to make sure we expand our perspective on finances. And anything else that I missed in terms of what we might be hoping to leave here with today in terms of accomplishing. Those are all So let me tell you, before we get into that, I just want to briefly tell you why I do what I do. And I know I explained this a little bit last week as well, but I want to make sure I'm constantly reiterating that. I'm a person that is extremely committed to the idea of financial freedom, right? So by that, I mean ownership, having ownership of your time, having ownership of your assets, having ownership of your resources so that you can choose what it is that you, the life that you want to live, but also you can choose to be an asset for God's kingdom, right? You can choose to bless people as you want to bless people, choose to bless your family as you want to bless your family, build up your community. I am extremely committed to that idea of financial freedom, which is why I do what I do, that independence. I'm also a person that's extremely passionate about my faith and just believing that God orders my steps, right? He's ordered my steps literally to be here today and doing what I'm doing, and that is the reason why I do what I do as a business. I'm essentially merging those two things. I'm taking that idea of financial freedom and building wealth and all of the things that come along with that, and I'm merging it with the principles that God has given us so that we become an asset in the kingdom, right? We're able to bless our community, we're able to bless our family, we're able to build up God's kingdom. That is why I do what I do. In terms of how I do what I do, it's through what I'm doing today. It's through financial education, seminars. I also do a number of clients that I work with in terms of business consulting, small businesses mostly, and as well as tax coaching, helping people understand the implications of their tax situation. Those are things that all encompass what I do in terms of my profession and my business. In terms of who I am as a person, I am a man of God first and foremost. I'm a husband. I am a father. I'm a member of the Overbrook Park Church of Christ. I've been a member of that congregation for plus 20 years now. So I have lived through a lot of the financial principles as well as a lot of the faith principles that I teach. And I just believe that I'm extremely passionate about using those things to honor God. So that's why I do what I do. That's how I do it. And now we'll get into what I actually came here to present. If you remember last week, I showed this picture, right? Anybody remember what a word that I used when I showed this picture last week?
Vision.
Vision, right? We talked about creating a financial vision. So last week, we spent a lot of time dealing with wealth, right? I'll try to write this big so everybody can see it. And we were talking about what wealth is, what wealth is not. And we tried to really redefine for ourselves what wealth is, right? As opposed to telling the world telling us what wealth is, right? Scriptures say, be not conformed to the ways of this world, but be transformed through the renewing of your mind. So rather than accepting what the world says is wealth, money, cars, clothes, all those things, we took a step back and said, okay, we're going to define wealth for ourselves based on God's word, right? So we talked about acknowledging God, right? Acknowledge him in all our ways. We talked about it's the Lord who gives us the ability to produce wealth, right? We started to talk a little bit about vision, and this is where I ended up last week. So I'm going to give you, first I'm going to give you my vision, and I'm going to ask someone or a few of you to share with me what your vision might be financially. The reason why I showed this picture is a picture of my wife and I. We were engaged at the time. We weren't married. My wife is a business owner as well as me. I didn't personally own a business. We didn't own a home. We were renters, didn't really have much to our name, didn't have a family, didn't have children, but for some reason, this picture for me specifically, this moment, this is on the Art Museum, Philadelphia Art Museum, I remember standing on those steps and I remember just God revealed to me somehow that, wow, there is so much ahead of us in our future. I didn't know exactly what it would look like. I didn't know my business would be called Blueprint Financial. I didn't know that my daughter would be named Ariana, but there were just certain things that God just gave me a vision to be able to see that there's so much ahead of us, right? And that vision helped me create what I like to call a financial vision. So that's going to be the purpose of today, right? So we took a step back and redefined wealth last time. Today we're going to talk about your vision, right? And I want you to be as specific as possible. So for me, my vision is, for my wife and I, we're both entrepreneurs, right? So my vision is that as entrepreneurs, we're able to create multiple streams of income, that we never have to be dependent on an employer or one source of income, but that we create enough opportunities in our lives where we have multiple streams of income. I believe in that. That's my vision for myself as well as my wife. I'm a father, right? So I want my daughter to someday have the option to go to college debt-free. If it's the Lord's blessing, I would like for my daughter to go to college paid for without debt. Mm-hmm. Now, she might have to contribute something to that, and she might have to work through it, but I don't want my daughter to come through in a situation that maybe me and my wife had experienced, which is a lot of debt, right? So that's a vision for me. So I make decisions every day that are based on that vision, that I want my daughter to go to college one day debt-free. I want to have multiple streams of income for my wife and I. We're fortunate enough to have a home. The Lord blessed us to purchase a home a year after we got married. I would like for us to own a number of homes, right? Mm-hmm. To be renters, to be able to perhaps have multiple properties whereby we can have income coming, regenerating back into our community, right?
Yes,
by investing in real estate, right? A number of people do it. A number of wealthy people in this country do that. So those are all things that are consistent with my vision. So we have to make decisions every day that are based on our vision. So that was my vision. I want to hear a little bit from some of you. What is your financial vision? What are some things, even if you don't have it specifically written out or listed out, what are some things that you want to see in your finances, in your future? Now keep in mind, the vision is something that doesn't necessarily exist today, right? At that time I had a vision, but I didn't know exactly what it looked like, what it sounded like. I just knew that God was revealing that there are some wonderful things ahead of us, right? So keep in mind, your vision may not necessarily exist today, but that's the point of the vision, because you're setting something up that's tangible so that you're working toward it. So I'm just curious to know, for anyone who wants to share, what is your vision? We'll start in the back and work our way up.
For me, I want to live without the fear that if I'm no longer working, the household will be stable. But not only that, I want to prepare for generations after me, generations beyond my son.
Yep.
And I guess that's pretty much.
Okay. I like that. I'm gonna come back to you in 1 second. So let's get your vision as well.
My vision is that, you know me, all of my stuff is extremely specific.
Gotcha.
So,
more specific the better.
All right, well, I've been working, I guess, probably for the past 2 years on trying to secure, financial opportunity for myself where I can bring in a specific amount per month.
Okay.
So that amount is basically, you know, 6 to 7 figures per month.
Okay.
I come from a heavy business and finance background.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that is also, you know, to basically provide, you know, resources and opportunities back to the community, because I want to grow additional businesses without the traditional means of using investments.
Okay.
So I want to create a different school of thought, because from all of my experiences, you know, starting my first company at the age of 16, being, you know, involved in tech and a bunch of different things, a lot of people who have good ideas, they have to leverage, you know, their ideas and give a lot of it away, even from the standpoint of, you know, being involved in real estate.
Yeah.
You know, it was told to me, you know, you can finance any idea, you know, you find an idea, the money's always easy. But the problem is, a lot of times the people with the money don't have the vision.
Right.
And you have to basically give away a portion of your vision just to get, you know, a step up. So what I've been working on is basically just trying to set myself up so that I will never have to use anybody else's money to pursue my own ideas, my own ventures, my own entrepreneurial endeavors, and then be that example ship, you know, so that other people can see how to do it for themselves.
Love it.
That's my vision.
Yeah. Very specific, very pinpoint, precise, as you are. I know your personality, your makeup, and you tend to be.
Yes,
but that's the thing about the vision, right? Like, the more specific, the better. Because at the end of the day, before I go too far, did I miss anyone else who wanted to share what their vision is, anything of that nature, Brother Ken?
Oh, let me run them in.
Yeah, exactly. So,
Rashawn,
go ahead.
My vision is literally to be
debt-free. Debt-free, yeah.
Very specific.
No debt attached to it, right? So if you notice, we've got a couple of different perspectives here, right? Like, the vision for me was entrepreneurship, multiple streams of income, getting into real estate. Dominique had mentioned living without the fear, you know, having financial stability if something happens to me, my family is still good. Wyman had mentioned having to be able to, I'm gonna try to paraphrase, which you were very specific, but being able to fund the ideas and the vision that you come up with without having to sacrifice your vision and use someone else's funds and thereby give up a piece of what it is you want to accomplish, right? All of those things are they vary, right? So it really doesn't matter, from my perspective specifically, what the vision is. What matters is that it's specific, right? It's specific, it's tailored to your individual situation, because you're going to end up making decisions every day with your finances that are going to affect, that are going to impact that vision, right? So in other words, you're either going to be led by the vision or vice versa, right? In terms of your financial decision making. One or the other is going to win out, right? The financial priorities in life, the circumstances, like you said, when you started out investing in properties and things, your circumstances were different. And then they changed, right? So those things happen in life. And we're either gonna hold to this vision and keep doing what we're doing, or we're gonna lose it, right? We're gonna sacrifice it in the process. Ken, I think I missed you.
Yeah. Well, I mean, for me, it's kind of similar to Dominique personally, but like I'm, I guess just only as specific as saying, like, from a personal level to make sure that home is taken care of, mm-hmm. not just now, but long after I'm gone, mm-hmm. to the point that it kind of builds into my next point, which is to help the church be financially stable.
Right.
And even spiritually stable, and then move into like even planting other works and training mm-hmm. other individuals. Mm-hmm. But so much personally where I'm set, the church is set, where you don't worry about a dollar amount to do
right.
whatever is necessary to
right.
build a kingdom or to build even another church
yep.
As we go forward.
Yeah, that makes sense. And that what you were saying, as you were saying it, it made me think of I believe it's in Matthew. Seek first the kingdom, right?
Yeah.
You seek first the kingdom in all your ways, and God will give us the desires of our heart. We're constantly seeking the kingdom, right? When Dominique had mentioned the fear, living without the fear financially, right? We talked about it a little bit in our last seminar. A lot of times we operate from a space of financial fear, right? God didn't give us a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, of a sound mind. Mm-hmm. But then, like, but we're people, right? We're human. Like, we have that fear. It exists. It's a very real thing. But the issue is not so much that it exists, it's knowing where it comes from, right?
Yes.
So we know that the fear is not coming from God. He's empowering us. He's giving us the tools to be able to make these decisions, so we learn to trust, and we learn to acknowledge, and we learn the process of it, so that we release that fear, and we're not operating from that space financially. So everything that's been shared so far, I love it. Anything that I missed in terms of vision, just what you want to contemplate? That's a testimony, and I love that, because what you're sharing in that is God's provision, right? What I hear underlying in that is that the Lord has already helped me accomplish where it is I wanted to get to, right? So I personally view that as a testimony, and that's inspiring for me. I hope it's inspiring for the audience, and hopefully what God is able to do is sustain that, right? Like, he's able to build that legacy so that those who come after you have that same experience, right? Because that's priceless, being able to experience what it is, everything that God had for you, and you were able to experience it. You didn't go hungry in the process of doing it. So that testimony is valuable. And we just want to make sure that as a people, so as a people, as a community, we want to make sure that we're empowered, so that we pass that on, that legacy gets passed on to our loved ones, so that they can experience, and our church can experience that same thing. So as you're saying that, there's a book that came to mind that I read recently. It's called The Seven Money Types. If you get a chance, I don't know what your schedule's like and how much time you're able to devote to reading, but there is a book that's very helpful. It's a spiritual-based book. It's called The Seven Money Types, and it goes through biblical figures in the Bible, from Isaac, Jacob, David. It deals with a number of people and God and the temperament that God gave them when it comes to money. God blessed all of us with a temperament, right? Meaning that some people are naturally givers. Some people are just inclined by God to give because that's how God blessed them financially, right? For others, it's a little bit more of a struggle to be able to say, that's not my natural makeup to give, right? But God blesses us with different temperaments. And the key in that is to recognize through your temperament, one, are you honoring God based on your personal makeup and how he made you to be financially? But then two, is that being abused? Because people can abuse that, right? So that question can really only be answered by you, right? Because my temperament is going to be different. What God blessed me with in terms of how I approach money is probably going to be significantly different. But it sounds like God made you, gave you an intrinsic ability to give whereby you feel blessed in giving, right? And not everybody feels that way. The only thing I will caution you about is that other people can see that. And sometimes people can take advantage of it. So I want you to read that book if you get an opportunity to. And one is going to help you recognize a lot of the patterns financially that you may follow, and it's going to help you see what other people see, right? Because other people might see something a little bit different. They may just see, you know what, I can get another $40,000 out of it, right? And you don't ever want to be in a position where you're abused, but you want to be in a position where you're naturally honoring God through your personality.
I feel God does answer prayers, and mm-hmm. God does see what every person does.
Mm-hmm.
God does know the mind of every
person.
The heart of every person.
Yep.
When I first came to this country, I used to go to a church in Pittman.
Okay.
And the pastor was building a church.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, who want to offer? They can offer $1,000, $2,000, how much they want to give, they can give.
Yeah.
And I took all the savings that I had in the house, was $1,400.
Mm-hmm.
$1,400.
Mm-hmm.
And I gave it all to the church.
Yeah.
And I felt blessed. Like I said, oh my gosh, I came from such God, from such a far place. I felt like an Ethiopian man. I said, oh my God, God brought me from such a far place to come here to have built a temple for the Lord.
Yeah.
Like I was so, I'm talking about it and I'm a theory.
Yeah.
And I felt so like, man, or like, I felt so like, I feel like I'm like a stress special
mm-hmm.
that God's using me this way
Absolutely.
To know my heart.
Absolutely.
And after that, I bought 3 properties.
Okay.
I still have 2. I gave one to my daughter and I have another one. My son is living in it. And I lost the first house I bought because it was too much for me to keep every month and I was still working.
Okay.
So I think God rewarded me.
Absolutely. And again, that the book that I'm pointing you to, it will speak to that, and it will give you a specific person in the Bible who has that same makeup that you do, right? And I want to say off the cuff, I think it was Joseph that they dealt with specifically who was naturally a giver. But I want you to read that book because it's going to help you identify. And all it's really going to do is just help you become more aware.
What's the name of the book?
It's called The 7 Money Types.
The 7 Money Types.
Yep. And it deals with 7 specific people from the Bible and how they approached money. And I believe it was Joseph who was very inclined to give. That there were times where, again, you want to have the awareness because you want to be able to see what other people see. So there were times that he was sort of taken advantage of. But at the end of the day, who he was naturally, he had to honor God through how he gave, through how he did different things, because that's how God made him. So that's really the only person that can answer that question is you, but I want you to at least have an awareness of what other people see when they see that giving taking place. But I believe you've been blessed and you'll continue to be blessed by being who God naturally made you to be. Anything else I missed in terms of vision?
I know you, because being married, our vision is going to be walking in the same direction. While our vision is alike, I just want to give the vision for specifically my business. I know we recently had conversations about this, but you know, I want to get to the point that my business is generating enough income that, you know, right now, like, sometimes they're, you know, being an entrepreneur, some months are like really, really good, and you know, and then some months, you know, aren't so good as far as like the income that comes.
machines or just changing our practices so that I'm able to keep more of that money so that I'm able to make more and also serve as a resource to the entrepreneurs. Since my top clients are entrepreneurs, I'm working a lot with people that have vision, that have different ideas for their businesses, and I serve as a resource to make to help them kickstart that. But that other piece is to now, a lot of times they come to me for advice on what to do at starting a business. And because I work with so many different business owners, getting so quick that I can link them together, that it can serve as a resource, that I can start to provide more things. But that piece I can't do until I'm able to really become more financially stable within my business.
Absolutely. This is all of what I'm hearing. Just speaks to how important it is to have vision, right? So imagine if you're operating without that vision, right? If you're just operating your vision, your business, I'm sorry, without knowing where it is you want to end up, without knowing specifically what you want to do, you know, what kind of clients you want to help, how you want to connect. Imagine it from that standpoint, right? Now you're really going in circles and your finances are operating under that vision, right? Your business finances are operating under that vision because it has to be specific. It has to go somewhere. And that's the whole point of the exercise of having you all kind of say for yourself, speak power, speak life into your own vision. And if you remember from this book that I had everyone take home last week, page one, what's your definition of wealth, right? That's your vision, right? Because how you define wealth is going to lead to your vision, which is why we started out last week. Let's properly define wealth first. Now we're gonna come up with a vision. So I love everything that you all have shared from business, from money regenerating into the business, funding things that you want to do, knowing when and how to give, financial stability, legacy, a greater perspective, like all of those things are really, really specific and are going to dictate our vision. So first biblical principle, I told you today we're going to transition a little bit more into financial principles, but I'm also going to give you the spiritual as well. The first principle is Proverbs 29 verse 18, if you happen to have it on your sheet, if someone can read it for me, or you can read it from the screen up here.
Where there is no vision, the people perish.
Right? So that's from Proverbs 29:18, right? There's nothing specifically about money in that scripture, right? But let's just say that we take that principle and apply it to our finances, right? So without a financial vision, without something specifically that you want to accomplish, your finances are going to perish, right? Because you're going to spend money on things, you're going to make money, possibly direct your energy making money in areas that don't align with your vision. So it's really, really super important, super critical financially that without a vision, your finances are going to perish. Like they are 100% going to go to areas that do not align with your vision if you're not very, very specific and intentional and deliberate in terms of how you set up your finances. Any questions on that?
No.
Okay. So let's transition a little bit. Psalms 127, verse 1. If anybody can read that, I don't think it's on the sheet here, but if you could read it from the screen, if anyone can you guys see that, or is that too small?
Unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain.
Okay, so let's take it a step further. We have our financial vision. Now, has anybody ever heard the term, get your financial house in order? So that is going to be an extension of your vision. We have to start to build our financial house. So what does that look like? If I'm building a financial house, what does that mean? Anybody have any thoughts on what that means? Somebody says, get your financial house in order, or build your financial, like, what does that mean?
I take it to mean basically, I look at it in terms of you give yourself a foundation and also a financial shelter.
Foundation as well as a financial shelter, okay, yeah. That makes sense.
So
makes sense.
The foundation would be, you know, something that would be able to set you up that you can build upon, but also, a safeguard, just in case. Well, the shelter part would be the safeguard, just in case, you know, things go to the left.
Yeah.
You know, they don't necessarily work out the way that you want them to.
Yep.
You know, you got your foundation, but it should also provide a shelter so that, you know, you can weather the storm, so to speak.
Got it. Okay. All right. That makes sense. Anybody else? If I say get your financial house in order, what does that mean?
For me, I think about because I recently learned that there are people that get paid and they just spend their money. But they don't keep up with it. They don't, you know, designate a certain amount of it for this or that. They just kind of spend it until it's gone.
Yep.
Usually they run out and then they're broke and they don't have it, the rest of it for other stuff. So for me, I'm kind of the opposite of that. And why I actually always laugh at me for this, but well, we just, I don't mean that in any way. But know, I can tell you probably what I intend to spend on this, you know, in 2 years from now.
Okay.
And the reason I do that is because for my Excel spreadsheet, I want to see, like, how much money am I making?
Mm-hmm.
How much is going to this? Because mm-hmm. then I can say, oh, no, I'm spending too much money on things that are just fleeting, you know, like something that's going to be gone. I can designate more money to this. So for me, building this financial house is saying, clean up the things, clean up the debt, make a plan to clean it up, and spend money where it's going to be more profitable. Mm-hmm. And just have an idea of where all of my money is going.
Okay. All right. I love it. I can appreciate that budget. I'll get you in 1 second. I saw your name.
Managing your finances.
Managing it. Okay. So tell me, go a little bit deeper. What does that mean, managing your finances?
Like, to budget yourself, like, don't buy more than you can chew.
Okay. All right. So your decision, it sounds like your decisions, what you decide to, I don't even know if I'm spelling that right, hopefully I have. What you decide to spend money on is very much going to resemble your financial house, right?
Yeah. The first thing you have to do, whatever income you have, the first thing you have to do. So much for giving.
Okay. Besides your gift.
For
okay.
God's kingdom.
Yep.
For the God's kingdom.
Yep.
That's the first thing you do. And then
first step. Yep.
You decide for your food.
Yep.
Your mortgage or your rent.
Yep.
And then whatever is left, you save from that.
Mm-hmm.
And then you spend from that.
Absolutely. You know what that sounds like? The budget? That sounds exactly like what we were just talking about, right? Your budget's going to tell you where you're spending the money, how much are you giving, how much are you using, like, where's that money going to? That's what a budget's gonna tell you, right? So your hand go up as well.
Yeah, I feel like it's probably related to all of these things, but when I think of building, getting a financial house in order, I don't know if you think of the structure like this, which is kind of like all of these things. You know, one is essentially, I guess, your blueprint, you know, like your, like, what are you allocating to this, what are you allocating to that, so I guess that's your budget. It's the fact that it's, when I think of a house, I think of protection, so I guess that means shelter. But essentially, coming up with a plan to get to your end goal.
Mm-hmm. So you want to have your plan in place so that you can get to your end goal. I love it.
I'm looking at your title, and it kind of made me think about building the foundation of your finances. So going back to kind of something we talked about last week, if you have the right foundation for your budget, then you're going to look at your budget in a different way. And you'll say, you know, I'm spending this amount of money on this thing, but if your foundation is right, then the spirit will be right.
Yep.
You'll say, you know, this is not even, like, even as a Christian, I probably shouldn't even be giving this much money to this thing. I can actually bring this more money over here, give it to offering, or give it to someone in need. So, like, that kind of helps me to look at my budget, too, because I say, you know, I probably shouldn't even, you know, I have $1,000 for me to go shopping, I can spend $200 shopping and then put the other $800 to go. You know, it's just amazing.
Yeah, absolutely. I love it. So you beat me to it, but I'm glad you did because we're getting there organically. But here's the point that the main point I was going to point out about building your finances, getting your financial house in order. Your financial house is very much going to resemble your spiritual house, which is why we spent a good amount of time last week making sure that we were defining wealth, making sure that we were acknowledging God in all our ways, making sure that we recognize that it's God who gives us the ability to produce wealth. Because once you start building your house, it's going to reflect spiritually what your house looks like, right? So that's why we have to have our spiritual house in order as well as our financial house in order, right? So we're working on both. We're working on both of those things.
Amen.
And everything you said is encompassing of that. But just to add to it, guess what? Unless the Lord is building that thing, right? Unless God is literally helping me build my financial house because it resembles my spiritual house, It's going to fall. It's either on sand or it's on the foundation, right? We talk about the solid foundation. I'm going to give you, in the financial world, what we've learned as there are six specific items that build your financial foundation. This doesn't deal with the spiritual. This is just what you learn in the financial world. The first thing is going, we pointed out, right? It's your cash flow, right? So if you are building a foundation, everything is going to start on your cash flow. The money that's coming in, the money that's going out, what are you saving, what are you giving? You have to have some type of foundation of your cash flow. Does your hand go up or are you just
No, I'll say it.
If you do have something, just jump in. I want to make sure I don't miss anybody. So that's gonna be the first thing is your cash flow. The The second thing, if you're building your financial foundation, is going to be your protection, right? How secure is that cash flow, right? Which speaks to insurance. You have to make sure that you are properly insured. Because guess what? As you build your financial house and you buy a physical house, a literal house, that house is going to need some insurance, right? As you take on a job and you become an earner in your family, or even if you happen to not have a family, but you recognize that one day, you know, God is going to call all of us home at some point. Somebody, even after we leave this earth, somebody's still going to be responsible for burying us, right? Somebody's going to have to pay the cost of that funeral. So there are just different things that we have to protect, whether it be our house, our vehicle, our life, our health, our family. All of those things are part of your financial foundation. The third thing, and again, this is all the financial, right? We dealt with the spiritual a little bit. I know I'm writing this a little small. Your taxes, right? That's as you're building up your financial foundation, you have to be aware, because what you're paying out in taxes is going to affect your cash flow. A lot of times in our communities and inner cities and minorities and so forth, we get these huge refunds every year. We get these huge tax refunds, right? What very few people may realize is that the reason why you get that refund every year, and it might be several thousand dollars, it's because you've overpaid taxes throughout the entire year. You've given Uncle Sam, IRS, you've given them more than what they actually required you to pay in taxes. So they say, okay, we're going to refund a portion of it back to you as cash, right? Meanwhile, that let's just, you know, I'm just using hypotheticals. Let's just say you got a $6,000 refund check, right, which is not uncommon in our communities, right? A lot of people live for their tax refund. That's an extra $500 a month that you could have used to build your financial house. You could have been giving, you could have been investing, you could have been securing your financial foundation, saving, whatever it is you want to do. But if we're not dealing with our foundation first, guess what? Without the vision, the finances perish. So we have to be able to see things for what they really are based on the Lord building our house, right? So these are the first three. My artwork is not very good, as I was reminded by my wife last night, so just bear with me. Now you got your foundation, now you gotta start to build on the roof, right? So as you're dealing with these areas, the next you're gonna start to do is your investing, right? You're dealt with your taxes, now you have to start to invest. Right? So what does that mean? When you start to invest, you're gonna have things that you're investing for in the short term, you're gonna have things that you're investing for in the long term. Long term might be more like retirement, things of that nature, or just leaving something for your family, even if you haven't already been retired. Short term might be, I just want to have a savings fund, or I want to purchase a home in a year, whatever it might be. That's going to be your short term. But you have to know how to invest as you're building up your financial foundation, right? On top of that, if you have a family, your family's going to want to be perhaps educated. So you're going to build your financial foundation. You see how you're building from the ground up first? And this is why I say, unless the Lord builds the house with us, unless God is literally helping me build my financial house, how do I prioritize all of these things, right? How do I invest, but still save for education, but still be able to have insurance, but still, like, these things are, they all compete with one another, right? So that's why you have to have the right foundation, the right builder. And finally, I'm going to put what's called on here, I'll use it. Is your estate. Your estate just literally means the value, the physical value of what you pass on to your heirs, to your descendants, to your family, whatever it might be. That is what's known as an estate. That deals with legacy, right? Because I talked a little bit about it in our previous workshop. In our community, a lot of times what we pass on is not so much an estate, we pass on debt, right? We pass on the bill, right? I gave the story about When my father passed away, there was no insurance. Like there was $200 in a bank account. Somebody had already beat me to the bank trying to get it out when I went there to just try to close the account. And I'm not saying that to complain. I'm actually saying that to give God glory, because we were still able to, as a family, come up with a plan to still have a funeral, still pay the cost of burial and all those things. And God provided, and I'm thankful that he did. But there was no estate. There was no insurance. Like, there was nothing there. And I was in a position personally to where I had to come, you know, I had to do something, right? We had to take care of it. And I was the only one in the position who was probably responsible enough to take on that type of responsibility. But again,
you just said something in your example, and yeah. I just want to kind of wrap my around. So here you have the plan, but you just said when it came to when Pop passed away, mm-hmm. that you said you put a plan together fast to take care of. So absolutely. In each step you do, you plan things out before absolutely. You're, okay.
Yep. And I'll be even more transparent. Thank you for pinpointing that for me. Part of that plan was, guess where I had to come? To Guy's house. That was part of my plan, right? I didn't want to, but I had to. I had to reach out to the church and say, here's the situation that I'm in. It wasn't their responsibility. I want to make that clear. It was not the church's responsibility to take care of my father's funeral or any of the cause, but they were gracious enough to help. And I'm thankful because I came to the church and I said, I've done everything that I know to do. Is there anything that the church can do to help? And when I said anything, I was just hoping they could give me $10, $20, whatever, right? I was just kind of in collection mode. And the church did significantly more than that, right? But I want to believe in my heart that the reason the church was willing to do that, one, because I was faithful, but then also I didn't give that responsibility to the church. I didn't show up with a bill and say, here's funeral bill, church paid. Like, no, I said, no, I here's my plan. I've done everything. I put up my own money. I've done a lot of things, and here's what I'm short. Can you help? Anything you do would be appreciated. And the church did significantly more than what I even asked for, but that's God. That's why it's important that the Lord builds the house.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes, sir.
Because God is significant, exceedingly abundantly above what I could have asked for. And thank God that there are givers, right? Going back to your question, there are people who naturally see a state of that type of thing going on, a state of need, and say, you know what? I can give to that. If everybody, if this world was full of people who had no temperament to give, it would be a much worse place than what we already see happening in the world. So I just share that testimony to let you know that the Lord has to be building that financial house at all seasons of life, right? Because things are going to change. Circumstances are going to come about in life. But financially, these are sort of like the six areas that build your foundation. I need to erase this, but I want to make sure everybody got a chance to see it. Everybody's good with it, all right? All right, so let's transition a little bit. I told Ken I didn't want to keep you guys here more than an hour, so let's transition a little bit. Second principle. Actually, this is the third principle for today. We talked about budgeting a little bit. Luke 14, verse 18. If someone can read that, it's on the back of your handout here of scriptures. Yep. So that actual principle, that scripture, actually does deal specifically with the financial term, right? The financial concept, which is cost. That's the whole concept of a budget, right? If God's word is telling us that, hey, if we're intending to build a tower, which essentially we are, we're trying to build our financial house, you have to first count the cost. You have to know, what is that going to cost me to retire? What is that going to cost me to have a cash savings fund? What is that going to cost me to have insurance, right? So you have to identify all of those things, and that's budgeting. That's what budgeting is. It's counting the cost of the financial decisions that you're going to make in your life, day in and day out. There's a cost for it. Every expense, everything that you devote money to has both a cost and a benefit, right? It has both. And you have to constantly be evaluating that so that when you're making those decisions every day, do I want to spend that $1,000 on shop? There's a cost to it. There's a value to it as well. There's a benefit. The benefit might be intrinsic. I might just feel better. What do you call it? Like shopper's therapy, retail therapy or something like that. It's not to say that there's not a benefit to it, but does that benefit outweigh the cost, right?
Also depends
where you shop. Where you shop, yeah. So that's part of your budget, right? Where you shop at, because that's going to determine how much money you spend. It's the difference in what you spend at Walmart versus what you might spend at at the thrift store, or even I was gonna say at Whole Foods, right? You go to Whole Foods, your bill's gonna look a lot different than maybe if you went to Walmart, right?
Yeah.
It doesn't mean that Whole Foods is bad. It doesn't mean that Walmart is good. It just means that in your budget, you have to identify both the cost and the benefit of every item in your budget. And that's essentially what a budget is. I wanna give you, try to be quick, a principle for budgeting, a financial principle. Anybody ever heard of the 80-20 rule? You heard of? Tell me what the 80-20 rule is.
Okay, 20% of the people do 80%.
Do 80% of the work. Okay. All right. So there's a couple of variations of the 80-20 rule. Anybody? No. That's good. That's more related to the sales implication of it. Anybody else have a different version of the 80-20? This is a couple of different versions. I'm gonna give you my version in a second.
I heard that version. Mm-hmm. I've also heard, in the sense of the I'll leave the financial part alone because I can't remember that part, but I've heard of it in the sense of relationships as well, and I don't think it's really different. But for finances, how does it go? It's like 20% of your money, or 80% of your money should be devoted to
I'll give it to you in 1 second. I'll give it to you in 1 second. Now you're there. You're right there. You're on the doorstep. You're right there. You're on the doorstep. I actually want to deal with the relationship part first.
Oh,
right?
You do?
Yes.
Okay.
It's very relevant. I will tell you why.
Like, maybe 80%, if a person has 80% of what you need or looking for.
Yep. I think the Tyler Perry movie was Why Did I Get Married?
Yeah.
He dealt with the relationship 80-20, right? Which means that in any relationship, right, I think he dealt specifically with marriage, but really you can apply it to any relationship, a friendship, relationships with your family members. You're only going to get about 80% of what you really, at best, you're only going to get about 80% of what you really seek and desire and need from that relationship, right? But let's just apply it in the principle of marriage, because I'm very blessed to be married.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to get that 80% in terms of your spouse who supports you, who builds you up, trusts you, loves you unconditionally, forgives you, whatever it is, you get 80% of that, right? That's what you need, really. That's what you need out of that relationship to sustain is somewhere close to that 80%. Mm-hmm. Relationships that don't really have that, you start to see them die off in life, right? Because there's no 80-20 principle there. What we tend to do is focus on the 20% that we want, but we're not quite getting, right, out of the relationship. And this winds up overshadowing all of the good that we get out of relationship, right? That's the way that it was kind of being presented. I'm paraphrasing, but that was kind of how it was pitched in Why Did I Get Married?
Yeah.
What I suggest to people that I work with is apply this to your finances, right? Realize that in your finances, when you're operating at the optimal level, in terms of your budget specifically, you're only going to be able to spend probably to get about 80% of what you need, right? There's always gonna be that 20% that you want to spend additional money on because it might have intrinsic value, it might have whatever, right? You might just want to spend additional money on it. That 20% tends to overshadow the 80% that we have that we're spending on our financial needs, because there's a difference in financial needs versus your financial wants. There is a difference. Anybody know the difference? Financial needs versus financial wants. What's the difference?
So give me a
practical example. What would be an example of a financial need versus a financial want?
I mean, I need a car to get back and forth to work. I don't have to spend $200,000 on one.
I see a little bit of it.
Okay.
You know, there was a period when I wasn't working and actually this really applied to it. I thought about what are the things that if I don't pay is actually going to negatively affect me versus other things where you may not have the money for it, but if you don't pay it, you know, it's not going to really affect you in any way.
Yep.
Like food, people would say food is a need, but I don't have to necessarily pay for food. I may ask a family member to give me food or something like that. So that for me wouldn't be a financial need.
Yep.
But to pay the electricity or something, you know, that would be a need. Because
right.
If I don't pay
can't be
that,
creative when it comes to the electricity, right?
Right.
Yeah. Okay. No, but that's, I mean, you want to say that's important, right? Creativity in your budget. You determine the ins and outs of your budget, where you can pull, where you can push.
I see where both of them are going with it. I agree. Well, actually, because it all depends on where you are financially, and then it goes back to your vision. So, for example, might have somebody that says, you know what, food is a need, I need to eat, you know, the family needs to eat, so I need to shop somewhere and it's really cheap, so we need to get what we can get at the dollar store and, you know, any type of cheap, you know, store to get food, but then you might have somebody that has a different vision, like money is still love, but my family's health is at the top of the list for my vision, so therefore, buying food at Whole Foods is worth that. I might sacrifice something else, but because the family's health is more important. So, you know, it can fluctuate and it can depend. So it may not always be because it's expensive or because it's not.
I'm going to use you as an example for something since you so graciously volunteered. You might kill me afterwards, but.
I volunteered.
Right. You volunteered, so I just accepted your volunteer. Through your question, you automatically volunteered. But it made me think of something very practical. At this time, when we were dating, actually before we got engaged, there was a period of time where you were pursuing your business full time, and you probably wouldn't want to share, but I'm gonna share it anyway. You were sleeping on someone's couch in order to fund your vision. I specifically remember at the dorm, shortly before this time period, right? So part of that vision is, I'm gonna be a successful business owner and I'm gonna do it at any cost. Not any cost, because you didn't sacrifice your integrity, but in terms of any financial, whatever it is I have to sacrifice financially, I'm going to get to the point that I need to be in my business. To the point that when we met, you were literally sleeping on somebody's couch, right? Right or wrong?
Not when we met.
You're right. When we started dating, we met when we were children. But when we started dating, that was your state, right? Just being completely transparent. So part of your vision at that time, which I noticed, I don't even know if you had fully identified it at that time, was that, no, I'm doing this for a reason. Like I have a choice. I could do some other things, but it would prevent me from getting where I want to be in my vision. And right now, that's the most important thing to me. So I'm going to sacrifice perhaps paying money for home rent, whatever it might be. You were willing to do that in order to, in the long term, to get to where you wanted to be in your vision. And I always thought that was valuable, right? So I wanted to share that in terms of transparency so that we have to understand the practical of it, right? Mm-hmm. Because we talk about financial needs and financial wants. A need for you at that time probably could have been my own apartment, right? That was a need. But the bigger need was, I need to align with my vision, which is being a successful business owner.
Can I talk about that?
No. Yeah. Go ahead. Absolutely.
So part of it was shame. You know, I'm paying bills. Like, and I thought you would leave me. So,
shame was not part of the vision.
Yeah.
Not part of it.
But you made a funny, you were just like, what is this? Like, you know, I was at an interesting point in my life when we started dating. You know, I had gone through a number of things in my life that had resulted in me being at a different place in my finances that I was used to. Because I had a good paying job and then life happened, you know. So I was at a place in my life that I wasn't proud of, but I realized that I wouldn't get out of it. And yeah, it was ultimately, I was still a business owner then, and I had a vision for where I saw myself and where I saw my business, but also my life. And I had a goal of becoming debt free at that point. And I actually was able to do that when I was student loans. At that time. Mm-hmm. But I knew that, like you said, it took humbling myself, it took, because that was a humbling experience to try to sleep on somebody's couch. But ultimately, it wasn't, when you do something like that, you have to have the vision for where you see yourself, otherwise that can become indefinite. And yep. You're just in a place that, yep. You know, that you go back, but if you see the light at the end of the tunnel, and right, by doing that, I was able to, like, knock off, like, all my bills mm-hmm. so that I could get back on my feet again, so.
So, and again, that all relates back to vision, right? And this is why it's so critical that spiritual house is going to reflect in your financial house, right? Mm-hmm. Because the thing that made the impression on me at that time was that, wow, you're still doing all of these things as a business owner, yet here's what you have to sacrifice financially, right? And you like you said, you gave up the good paying job and all those things because you were very much invested in where you wanted to go in your vision. So that's what stood out to me, as opposed to the specific circumstances. The circumstances were what they were. Like, I knew you had somewhat of a choice of how you proceeded, but what made the impression on me is that you were still working towards your financial vision of being a successful business owner. Ken, is your hand going up, or you just...
No, my hand going up. I think that point that you said, Deanna has started, and then you kind of wrapped around with the story. It's like mm-hmm. a part of recognizing your need is sacrificing for it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, would you keep a car... Not even purchasing a car, but you got a car. Mm-hmm. I mean, would you keep that? My cousin, he bought a car in 1997. The intention was never to get rid of that car until mm-hmm. he was debt-free. Mm-hmm. It died. He had to get something else, but then he's kept it since then. You know, it got like 200-something thousand miles on it. But the mindset is, we got to clear up all of this mess,
right.
And I refuse to go get something newer.
Yeah.
Because I have to take care of the need.
Yeah.
Where that need weighs out. Yeah, I think that's
so you beat me to it, but here's a scripture that I want to direct us to, and it's, can correct me if I'm pronouncing it wrong. Haggai.
It's good enough.
1:5-7. And it's kind of like an obscure scripture. It's not one that's often quoted, but I'll read it because it's a little lengthy. And this is God speaking to the nation of Israel. Am I right about that, Ken?
Just want to make yes.
Sure yeah. Context. All right. Speaking to the nation of Israel, who we know in the Old Testament, that was God's people. That was his people. And this is essentially God reprimanding them, telling them, you have planted much, but harvested little.
Mm.
You eat, but never have enough.
Mm-hmm.
You drink, but never have your fill. You put on clothes, but are not worn. You earn wages, only to put them in a purse with holes in it, right? So this was God's reprimand to the nation of Israel, right? And in that time in the Old Testament. So what this tells us, specifically the last part of that scripture, which uses the financial term wages and earning, sometimes we can put our earnings into our pockets that have holes in them, right?
Mm.
And that goes back to the point about spending. There's a such thing as financial needs, and there's a such thing as financial wants. The difference is your financial needs are going to sustain you,
mm-hmm.
right? Your financial wants are really only going to entertain you. At the end of the day, the things that you spend money on that are your financial wants, they just have entertainment value. They give you some kind of stimulating feeling, but they're not really going to sustain you, meaning after that, after you spend money on that item, there's not much value afterwards, right? It might be in the moment, it might last for a day, for a week, whatever it is, but afterwards, you're kind of back at square one, whereas when you're spending money on your financial needs, those things are generally sustaining you, right? So you're spending money on your home, for example, if you happen to become a homeowner. The reason why you're putting money into your house is because it appreciates in value. Right? So at the end of the day, you have what's called equity because your house is appreciating in value. It's an appreciating asset. That's a financial need. That's something that's going to sustain you. I saw your hand go up. You have a question?
My financial vision is multiple streams of income. Mm-hmm. One of them, I'd like to turn the my liabilities into an asset.
And I love that you shared that specifically because of the car situation, right? Going back to the concept of financial needs and financial wants, a car is a little bit of a gray area, right? Because it can be both, right? If you have you need to earn income rather, your car is a vehicle that's going to allow you to do that. So you need your car to do it, right? But having a car that you can't necessarily afford or that you have to go into excessive debt in order to own or to have, rather, you don't actually own it until you pay it off, that becomes a financial want, right? And the car, as opposed to the house, is a depreciating asset, meaning that it's going down in value over time. So that's where you have to be careful about those financial needs and those financial wants.
Yep. The car is paid for.
The car is paid for, absolutely, right? Absolutely. So that's why I'm glad you shared it. You shared that example. Because the point is that it can be both, depending on the car, depending on who's paying for it, like all of that, right? It can be either one. So that's what we have to make critical decisions.
We have like cars for high models.
Okay.
Yep.
Rashawn, I saw your hand go up as well.
I just wanted to add, actually hearing about Deanna's story really blessed me because when I went to college, long story short, I had 2 bachelor's degrees. So I'm not saying that to boast. I'm saying that to say when I went to college the first time, I didn't have any debt. But I went back to nursing school and I had to take out over $100,000 in debt. So the couple of years that I wasn't paying them off aggressively, they really grew over time. And now I'm at 160. So I'm saying this to say, I decided a couple months ago to move back in with my mom because people say, oh, you're a nurse, you can afford to live at home. I can afford to, but when I think about rent and my renter's insurance and my utilities and all that, that's like over $1,000 that I can actually save. soon when I say, like, you know, my goals of health, my student goals, like, I'm actually working on that because I get a lot of pushback from everybody all the time. They're like, it's okay, you know, people have goals all their lives. I said, no, my plan is going to take me 3 years to pay off, but that's 3 years versus me having to take me for the rest of my life.
Right.
So that really blessed me because I said, oh my goodness, like, you know, it's hard for anybody, I think, to move back in here, especially if you have not been home in a long time. But it just helps me to keep that in mind because for me, that's really important. Like, being debt free, that is my debt, and I have a plan where God has blessed me to be able to do this in 3 years versus, you know, like the rest of my life. So,
no, that's
really a blessing.
That's great. That's great. And here's the thing about the vision. Like, you can't expect everybody to have to understand the vision because it's your vision, right? It's your financial vision. So other people are going to see your vision and say, that's crazy. Like, why would you do that? But using Rashonda's example, my vision is to be debt-free. So the decisions that I'm making financially are lining up with that vision. Whereas your vision might just be, I just want a nice car. I just want a nice apartment. So to someone else, like, just, you know, it's really important that we recognize that not everybody's going to understand the vision. But from God's standpoint, that's why it's important that we allow Him to be the builder, to help us build the financial house, right? As we're spending, making sure that we're spending things, like, what are we spending money on that's sustaining us versus the things that are entertaining us? One more thing I'll cover on the budget principle, 80-20. I am very much an advocate of doing what's called percentage-based budgeting. All that means is that every item that you list out in your budget, you have to calculate what percentage is that of your total spending, or really of your total income, rather. So when you're looking at your budget and you're calculating your financial needs versus your financial wants, you want to make sure that 80% of your budget, that's pretty much 80% of your income, rather, that you can live off of that, right? That's a good target. That's a good solid goal to shoot for. That whatever amount of money that I bring in income, whether it's $1,000, whether it's $10,000, 80% of that is going to go toward my budget. Going to go toward the things that have to fund my everyday life, right? That leaves 20% to do what you want, right? So that 20%, you can say, hey, you know what? And I'm just using round numbers. I'll give 10% of it. I'll save 10% of it. I'll give 15% of it, right? So now you have the discretion, right? This is the discretionary part of your budget where you can say, I can use this 20% to do what I want to do, right? Save, invest, give. Bless others, whatever it is that you want to do, but you know that your financial needs are taken care of because you're focusing on that 80-20 rule for your budget. I'm living off of 80% of the income that I'm bringing in. I'm structuring percentage-based budgeting. Everything in my budget has a specific percentage assigned to it, and when I add those things up, they're no more than 80% of the money that I bring in. 20% of it, that's discretionary money. I can do what I want.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
I don't want to sound stupid, but I'm going to just ask it. When you say that 20% is now discretionary, that is discretionary income?
Correct.
Is that something?
Right. That's your discretionary income. Correct.
Okay.
Yep. That is the money that you literally have the discretion or the choice to use it as you see fit.
Okay.
So here's the thing, right? So I'm going to break that down a little bit more. So there's a difference in the discretionary income versus the discretionary spending. Because when you look at your budget, this 80% is going to include both discretionary spending, it's going to include fixed spending, it's going to include all of your spending, right?
Okay.
So the discretionary income is what's left over. But your discretionary spending, the expenses are going to be encompassed in that 80%. Does that make sense?
That makes sense. Yeah,
because certain expenses, I'll be more specific, certain expenses that we choose to spend money on are either discretionary or not, right?
Yeah.
So when we spend money on our rent or whatever it costs to maintain the house, right? Utilities, all of those things, there's usually not a lot of discretion that I can apply in that. Like, I think when somebody gave the example of the electric, I can't get too creative when it comes to the electric. I can try to do something. Of course, you want to make sure your lights are out and people, you know, if y'all anything like me, you grew up, you know, your parents like, don't turn on that air yet. We not turning on the electric bill, the light bill. You still have the light bill. You're not running up the light bill yet. And you can do those things, and that's responsible. But it's only, at the end of the day, it's only going to make so much of a dent in your utility bill, right? Because electric is what it is. Water is what it is. Gas is what it is. So you want to make sure that you don't abuse it so that you don't have an unnecessary bill. But you need the lights on to see. If you want to read, you know what I'm saying? Like, you don't have a lot of discretion in that. Your discretionary spending might be on the weekend. I can either go to a movie. I can go out with a friend to dinner. I have some discretion. I can say, you know what? Why don't we just go out next week, save a little bit this week, right? Or I can tell someone, you know, I want to go on a trip. Maybe I'll do it in a couple of months. I have the discretion to save that money a little bit more, so I'm going to do that instead. That's what you have discretion with, right? But again, you got to understand, is it a financial want or is it a financial need? And that's going to be encompassed in your 80%. 20% is what's left over. You can give, you can save, you can invest. You can do what you want with that money. But if you can get to a place where you're comfortable, I won't even say comfortable, where you're proficient enough to live on 80% of what you make, you'll be in a very good place financially to be able to save, invest, and do things that you want to do. Any questions on that?
Okay.
All right. I'm going to try to get through. I know we're over time. I'm going to try to get through it in about the next 10 minutes or so. Next area area of scripture. And again, the point in giving you scripture in this is because oftentimes we only see God's word when it comes to giving, right? Mm-hmm. If I were to ask you, hey, what scripture do we use for giving? Probably anybody in this room could tell me the scriptures that we use for giving. If I were to say, what scripture do we use for getting some insurance? Most people probably wouldn't know, or they'd be like, you know, you gotta scratch your head a little bit, or what's the principle behind it? Not so much what's the instruction in it, because the Bible it talks extensively about money, so certain things are given to us as instructions, certain things are just given to us as concepts. Scripture in 2 Corinthians 2, verse 14, I'm sorry, 12, verse 14. If somebody wouldn't mind reading it, it's on the back of our sheet as well.
Here, for this third time, I am ready to come to you, and I will not be a burden to you, for I do not seek what is yours, but you. For children are not responsible to save up for their parents, but parents for their children.
Okay, so this is 2 Corinthians, right? So, Ken, to the best of my understanding, was written by Paul, correct?
Yeah.
So Paul, notice in this message, right? The message isn't even necessarily about money, but guess what gets dropped in there? Responsibility, saving, right? And it just gets thrown in there, but it's in God's word for a reason, right? Mm-hmm. So when we're thinking about the principle behind protection, behind insurance, it goes back to this. There's a responsibility to it, right? Sure. There's a responsibility, especially if I'm a parent. Meaning I'm a parent of a child who's not even like legally able to take care of herself. That child is not responsible for me. I'm responsible for that child financially. So therefore, in terms of insurance, I'm applying this biblical principle that, you know what, as a parent, I have to do what's responsible for my child because something could happen to me, right? I could lose my life. I could lose my health. I could lose my car. Whatever it is, those things need to be protected. So that's the principle that we apply. And what I put up here at the top, the financial protection must be a purpose, right? Because a lot of times we might go out and get insurance and do different things of that nature. We don't even really know what the purpose is of it, right? We don't even know how, like, we haven't really identified that. So our provision, our protection should always be with a purpose. I'm getting insurance, life insurance specifically, because I'm protecting my life. If something should happen to me, the purpose is that my child should suffer minimal financial impact. They're gonna suffer a lot of other things, but I'm gonna decrease that burden of the financial impact of it, right? If I'm getting insurance for my car, for my health, there's a purpose to it, right? I'm getting insurance on my health because if something happens to me, my child needs to, you know, or something happens to my child, I'd rather them be able to be seen by a doctor in that moment, right? And be seen at a hospital, right? Or even for myself, I want to die in a hospital bed. I don't want to die out in, like, you know, somewhere somebody couldn't see me because I didn't have no insurance. So just certain things for me personally, that's how I approach it, is there's always a responsibility to it. That's the purpose of getting insurance. That's the purpose of the protection is to take on the proper responsibility. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Any questions? And again, that scripture isn't even necessarily in the context of money or anything, but it's in there. It's in God's word. So we're taking that principle and applying it to our finances. Try to give you one more debt. This is one of everyone's favorite topic, and I understand why, because there are a lot of differing viewpoints on debt. In terms of God's viewpoint, or at least what he communicates to us through his word, if someone could read Proverbs 22, verse 7, it's on the sheet, first page, the front of the sheet, or you can read it from the screen.
The rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender.
Okay, so let's break that down a little bit. Borrower, lender. That's essentially dealing with debt, right? Because there are only two things you can be when it comes to debt. Right. You can either be a borrower or you can be a lender. You can choose not to participate at all and not take on debt. So that actually is the third option. But in terms of if you're going to take on debt, you're either the borrower or the lender, right? that scripture in and of itself, it doesn't necessarily make that bad. It doesn't make that good. All it's doing is putting it in this context, right? It's helping you understand that if you're going to take on that debt, someone's going to be the borrower and someone's going to be the lender, right? Now, there are situations in God's word where, particularly in the nation of Israel in the Old Testament, they were the lender, right? They were the lender, and God told them that he wanted them to become the lender instead of the borrower, right? Like, that's in God's word. I didn't pull that scripture out specifically. But again, it's not that debt in and of itself is a bad thing any more than money in and of itself is a bad thing. It's the love of money that becomes the root of all evil, right? So when we're managing debt, we just have to understand that's always going to compete for first place, right? So that means that when I want to serve God and when I want to do certain things with my money, debt is always going to be there to raise it. Oh, wait a minute, but you owe me first, right? So I might want to give more. I might want to bless my family more. I might want to get more invested, but debt is going to compete for first place, right? And that's what happens when we become the borrower instead of the lender. So we have to be mindful of that as we're making decisions financially. Am I going to choose to swipe this credit card? Am I going to choose to take on debt for something that might be a financial want as opposed to a financial need? Understand that you're placing yourself in a position of borrower. And the borrower is the servant. But let's take a step back and deal with money a little bit. Money is, just using it in the context of this, money is a very good servant,
yeah.
But it's a terrible master.
Yeah.
When money, when debt, things like that rule over our lives, it's a terrible situation. But when we determine what's going to happen with our dollars, with our money, we put ourselves in the best position. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So we want to make sure that we're mindful of that. The last thing I'll cover, I didn't get to the book yet, but I'm going to give you something out of the book. It's going to be homework. It's going to be something you can take home today and do it immediately to start to see progress in your finances, right? Before I get to that, I want to cover what's known as your FICO credit score. Anybody familiar with that? The FICO score. Can somebody tell me what that is? Anybody? What's the FICO score?
Based off of what your liability exposure is, you know. So, but you need it. So, you know, I think with a comfortable range where they like to see it's like, you know, 20% or something like that on credit or something like that. You know, so to keep it high, but anything that gets close to like, you know, 40 or 50% will basically take it and drop it. And of course, if you go over it, you know what I mean, you're in a bad place.
Anybody else on the FICO?
So
everything that you all mentioned is part of the FICO score. I'm going to give you two different perspectives on it. So one, I'm going to give you the technical definition of what FICO means. FICO literally stands for Fair Isaac Corporation. That's the technical, not that you need to know that, but I just want you to have the background. So this came from, I think it's back in the 1960s. Two gentlemen got together, I think it was Isaac Fair and somebody else. Fair was the first gentleman's last name, Isaac was the second. They got together and said, why don't we establish a scoring system so that when people want to borrow or make decisions on their credit, there's something to evaluate. So they literally came up with a system that assigns a number to your credit. It's a scoring system. That scoring system exists today, and this is what is most commonly used by most lenders. If you have to borrow for a car, for a house, you get a credit card, any form of credit, any credit interaction, almost everyone is going to look at your FICO score. It's the most popular score. What this tells the person that's going to lend you money is, I can give them some good terms to borrow on, or I can give them some bad terms to borrow on. The lower your FICO score, the worse your terms are gonna be. Meaning that the interest rate is gonna be higher if you have a lower credit score. Interest rate is gonna be lower if you have a high credit score, right? The things that you can actually borrow money for, the amount of money that someone is willing to let you borrow, is going to be dictated by your FICO score, right? And the only way to come up, and this is where you have to be really, really intentional, because FICO, your credit score, is determined by your credit history, right? So it's possible to have a low credit score or have no credit score simply because you don't have credit history, right? So this measures your interaction with credit and debt throughout the course of your life. Like, it's literally taking inventory of the things that you borrow money for, how soon did you pay it off, were you late, were you delinquent, did it go into default, did it go into collections, and it's establishing a number to give you, to assign. Each and every one of us in this room has a FICO score, whether you realize it or not. You have a FICO score. And what's generally considered a good FICO score is somewhere around 700 is considered good. Your FICO score, to the best of my knowledge, can go as high as like 830 or 850, I believe. So that gives you some perspective on how high it can go. But 700, 720 is kind of generally the consensus of what's considered good credit.
I just want to say really fast, because that actually touches on what we talked about last week. It seems like the system is set up for us to have that, because I've actually paid off credit cards in full before your credit score goes down, because you're closing lines of credit.
Yep.
It can seem that way.
Yep. So I'm gonna do my best to run through this in about 5 minutes, and I'll let you all have your day. But we are going to deal, as you take your book home, this is gonna be homework for you. On page 19, this is what I want you to do. There's a small box on page 19, and I want you to take that and list out your credit cards. I want you to list out the amount on your credit card. Not for me, this is for your own personal exercise. The interest rate and what you pay each month. Gives you a little section to do that when you get home. If you need more space than this, let me know. I'll send you something else that you can write on. And then it gives you a strategy. Write down three specific strategies for how you're going to reduce your debt. Because all of those things are going to dictate your FICO score. Your FICO score, I wrote down some numbers up here. You may not be able to see what I wrote down based on where you're sitting. But there's pretty much a ratio that goes into your FICO score. 35, 30, 15, 10, 10. If you notice, all these numbers add up to 100, right? 35% of your credit score, your FICO score, is going to be based on your payment history. Meaning, do you pay your bills in full? If you're borrowing, if you happen to be using credit, do you pay them off on time each month in full? That is going to build 35% of your credit score. And you can go to FICO.com and give you a little more breakdown. 30% is based off of what I would call your debt utilization, right? Which is how much of your debt is actually being used based on what's available to you, right? So a lot of times, if you'll notice specifically with credit cards, you may get a credit line for $5,000, right? And some people will go immediately and spend $5,000 and max it out. Essentially, what you're telling those who evaluate your credit score, your debt utilization is not good, right? Because you're utilizing 100% of your available debt, right? Generally, what lenders like to see when it comes to debt utilization, incidentally, is somewhere around 30%, of your available credit that you're using it.
Oh, and not to forget, 35, like that 35% factor, you're actually paying it off each month in full. So if you go and swipe your credit card, you spend $100, you pay it. You pay it off. Not the $20 minimum that they tell you can pay, but the entire $100 is paid off within 30 days so that you're not charged interest, so that you paid off, you paid that balance back down to zero. So that's telling the lenders you have favorable payment history. Now you have good debt utilization, right? Because you're only using, you're not using all of the available credit that's available. So you're not maxing out the credit card. You're not maxing out all the loans and different things of that nature. Some of these smaller items I'm going to briefly, just for the sake of time. There's also credit mix, where they're looking at how much of your credit is actually revolving debt versus installment debt. Revolving are the things that become like a revolving door, right? So, for example, credit cards are revolving debt because there's no set payment time, there's no set payment, the interest rate can fluctuate, right? Versus, say, a home loan is what's called installment debt. So there's a set period, you know exactly how long the length of your loan is going to be. There's a set payment, there's a set interest rate, generally it's not going to fluctuate. If you borrow at 4%, it's going to be 4%. And when you pay it off in 5 years, it's done, or 30 years, or whatever it might be, it's done. That's considered installment debt. There's differing views on that, right? Because some people say, okay, well, revolving debt is bad, installment debt is good. Sometimes that's just a general mindset because, the revolving debt is a revolving door. The credit cards, the store cards, the limits, things like that. I'm going to challenge that viewpoint a little bit in these last 2 minutes. And I want you to consider that there's really no such thing as good debt or bad debt, right? It all depends on how you use it. For example, I'll use what's considered good debt. Let's just say a house. Let's say that I purchased a home, and a year later, it's installment debt, right? So it's set payment term, set interest rate. I know exactly how long it's going to take me to pay it off. But let's just say a year from now, I stopped making payments, circumstances that came about, and I can no longer make it, and I defaulted on my mortgage. Is that good debt or is that bad debt? It's bad, right? In that situation, it's bad. Even though it started out as what was considered good, a home loan installment debt, if you can't pay it, if you can't afford, and you go into default, now it's going to impact your credit, and it's no longer good debt, right? Let's say that you get the revolving debt, which is a credit card, but you pay it off in full each time, every month, right? Whatever it is that you borrow, you pay it off in full, so you're not carrying a balance, right? Let's say that you don't spend more than 30% of your credit limit. Every month, you're consistent, right? Is that good debt or is that bad debt? It's actually working in your favor, right? It's actually working good. So again, it's not so much that the debt is good or bad. It's about how do you manage these factors. And again, a couple of them I couldn't get into just for the sake of time, but there are about five specific factors: debt utilization, payment history, credit mix, and there's some smaller factors as well. And I'm going to kind of skip over that. But again, all those things go into your FICO score, which again just tells the lender, I can give this person a loan, or I can give the person this credit at this enormous interest rate, or I can give it to them at this low interest rate. You always want the terms to be favorable for you. And the only way to really do that is to work on your credit score. Again, be mindful. Credit is leverage, right? Credit is the option. You don't necessarily have to go into debt. You don't necessarily have to use your credit, but it helps if you have it available, right? If you're in good standing in terms of your credit, because then for those things that may align with your vision, there may come a point in time where you want to build your business out. And you got a good FICO score, so you can do something. You can borrow other people's money to make money in your business, right? Because you've established that. You can also establish good credit for your own business. It's not even in your name. It's in your business name, right? You might want to have those multiple streams of income to purchase some real estate. You can use credit to do that, or you cannot use it, right? But this gives you the option to do it, right? And this is what, not even so much just the FICO score, but credit itself. That is really what super wealthy people have done in this country for a very long time to be able to become wealthy, is they use someone else's money. And then they make a return, they make money off of it, pay back what they owe. What they owe was less than what they earned. That's really the basic premise of it. So that's what I wanted to share with you in terms of the debt portion. Now we went a little bit over it today. But make sure on page 19 that you take time to do that exercise to go through write down your specific debt amounts, your specific debt goals, and next week we can kind of go a little bit deeper into the financial concepts and how you can make progress on it. Any final questions, any final comments, Anything that we might have missed today? Any therapists?
Good information.
Thank you.
A lot of information.
Good. Good. That is the goal, is to bless God's people with value on the mission. That's it. I'll turn it over to my brother Kent.
I give my hand. It's funny you kept saying, like, we got 2 minutes left, and I looked up and I'm like, it's an hour 25.
Yeah, no, I didn't even realize. Because the information is, you know what I'm saying, so good. But I just appreciate him so much more. And I know he's already said stuff about himself, but you know, one of the things I'm also happy to see, that's my boy, you know what I'm saying? I can go back and say that like that, you know what I mean? But he's documented, not just in what he's done, but he also writes professional articles on finance that are published right now. So he ain't say it, but you know, I had to embarrass him. See, embarrass my sister, let me stop. But it's all good. But what we're going to do now, we're going to close in a word of prayer, and then we're going to go back and we're going to eat. Now, for my vegan food eaters, Rashana, you're going to be mad, and that's all I'm going to say. We got some stuff for y'all, though, in particular. Yeah, Rashana going to be mad, and I had to just leave that for her. But let's go to God and pray together. Let's go. Most gracious, honorable Father God, we're thankful for today. We're thankful for this moment in time that you bless all of us to be here. To participate in this workshop, Lord, it has been a blessing to all of us, even in challenging our preconceived notions on what we may have already thought, dear Father. We're thankful to have Brother Brian Murray, dear Father, to be here to bless us with this information that it might cause us to do better as individuals that may have debt, but just better in our finances, dear Father, that we can truly be a shining symbol of your glory in every aspect of our lives. Father God, we ask now a blessing on the Murray family, dear Lord, as he's invested his time to come here and just to share some impactful information with us. And we pray for the food that has also been prepared for all of us, dear Lord, that we might enjoy this food, enjoy this fellowship, let the food truly be nourishment to our bodies. Gracious Father, we pray and we ask it all. Let's all say amen.
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 If you all wouldn't mind, I want to get a picture of us in front of this deck out here that my wife will love and design for us. So, if you don't mind being in the picture.
Hello, there, Lou. How are you?
Thank you.
How are you doing?
That's all good.